We want to welcome you guys this morning, and we want to invite you guys to stand with us and sing as we worship together.
My Savior loves, my Savior lives. Savior lives, my Savior lives, my Savior lives.
While everyone's standing, why don't we just introduce ourselves to each other and wish everyone a happy Sabbath. While everyone's finishing up, I wanted to mention briefly our Connect card. The Connect card's in the bulletin, and this is a great way for you to contact the church, the pastors, the elders, to ask any questions, ask for assistance, ask for prayer. Please feel free to fill that out, and typically we'll pick that up at the end. Also, if you have any changes in your contact information, that's another good way to do it. And if you're a visitor, please feel free to fill it out so we can know who you are. We have a couple of other brief announcements. Today is churchwide fellowship dinner, so if you're a visitor, please feel free to stay afterwards and we'll have food that's blessed, if not completely healthy, but blessed at least. And then tonight is a continuation of our seminar on America in the end times and what it role it may play. It starts tonight at 5:30. It's right here in the Fellowship Hall. Last night was a good opening, a good framework for what we're going to be looking at, and sort of a bit eye-opening, so I think it's well worth coming to as well. We have another couple other announcements. The pastor here is going to talk briefly.
All right. Good morning, church. So some of you were in here a few minutes ago when we showed a video. We showed it really with no introduction, but just to kind of follow up with that and let you know what that was. You have an insert in your bulletin. It looks like this. And on April 2, there's going to be a benefit called Delete Blood Cancer. And they're going to be raising money for that cause in memory of Gianmarco Verhel. Do some of you guys know the Verhel family and the story there? Precious little boy, he passed away about a year ago, and family lost their little boy. You can see a picture of him there. And so they're doing this special drive in honor of him at Southwestern Adventist University. And so you can read more about it here, and we just wanted to make you aware of that next weekend on Sunday, all right?
Delete a blood cancer drive, basically what someone would do, what to expect would be you go there, you get some information, they ask some questions, and then after that you swab your cheek, and they send that off, and usually you become part of a registry, and if you're a match for anyone, they'll give you a call. Years ago, they used to stick a needle in your bone, in your hip, and extract your cells that way. However, it's become a lot less invasive now. Basically, they stick like an IV in your arm and they can extract your stem cells through your blood. We know there are a lot of parents that, or other people in general, adults and children, that have this need, and we'd love to do this in honor of our son.
All right. It's now time for our tithes and offerings. So, Buddy, would you come and share with us?
Morning. Happy Sabbath. So those of you that are playing guitars, that's awesome, okay? And if you think that, like, those of us that are out here sitting in the pews don't appreciate it, we really do, because it really is awesome. And if you keep giving your talents to the Lord, you're going to get blessed, and you're going to bless a whole lot of people for the rest of your lives. So it is a big deal, okay? The adults too, by the way. Today's offering is for the local budget, but it's specifically for the fireworks that we do, which is really cool. You know, our community knows our church, and a lot of them, when I talk to them and stuff, oh yeah, you're the church up on the hill that everybody goes and, you know, does the fireworks thing. That's a good thing. That's not a bad thing, you know, because we need to somehow give to the community and let the community that we care, we want them to be part of our lives and part of what's going on. And it's a great opportunity for us to show, you know, who we are as Christians. So the offering today is for that reason. I'm going to walk around with this box until it's full of cash, so get ready. Actually, the ideal thing for me to do, but I couldn't do it, was I want to fill this up with fireworks and then just throw a match in it and walk away. If we were outside, if we had done outside church today, I would have done that, and you'd all have had a duck while the bottle rockets fly by. But since I can't do that, I just hold the box up here, and we'll have to save it until the actual fireworks happens. Have a great Sabbath. Let's say prayer. All right, let's go ahead and bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you give us, because everything is yours. You tell us specifically to give 10% back to help run the organization, and then to give an offering out of our hearts. So, Lord, what we really ask is that we will give everything that we own, our time, our resources, our children, everything. Help us to be your missionaries, first in our homes and then to our neighbors. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, this is the time the adults love best. It's children's story. Jennifer Smith's going to come up here and help us. So, all right, kids, this is where you go through the aisles as you come up, and the adults are going to hand out little $1 bills for you to gather and put into our baskets. So, all right, kids, come on up. We've got a good story. We've got chairs here as well as the stage, so feel free.
Hey, guys, come sit on the stage right here in front of me. Okay, can you guys turn and face me up here today? That way we don't have to have those chairs in front of us, huh? You guys did so good. Look at all that money. Good job. A few of you kept a few extras. The basket's over there. It's okay. We'll pass around the basket. Can you bring the basket up here, baby? There we go. All right, well, good morning, guys. How are y'all doing? Did y'all sleep really late this morning? Yes, then you should be energetic. Oh, you got your parents up early? My baby got us up early this morning at 6 a.m. Oh, her baby brother got her up. That makes sense. Okay, so I have a story for you guys. Thank you so much. Thank you. Here's my story for you guys, but I wonder if you can figure it out before I tell you who it's about, okay? So are you ready to put your thinking caps on and have some good guesses? Okay, here we go. First, I have a question, though. How many of you have either a brother or a sister? Raise your hand. How many of you have more than one? How many of you have more than two? How many of you have more than three? How many of you have more than five? Josiah's crazy because I know he's only got one. Eunice, he thinks y'all have five. Okay, I know someone in the Bible who had 11 brothers. Can you imagine having 11 brothers? I had just one, and that was a lot. Okay, can you imagine having 11? How are you guys so smart? You can't spoil it. I've got a whole bunch of other hints. Pastor Ryan, I don't know where you went, but your little boy already knows who I'm talking about. So, here we go. Did you know that his dad's name was Israel? Okay, on top of that, he had a pretty sharp-looking coat. You know who I'm talking about? Yes. Who?
Joseph.
Joseph. And were Joseph's brothers very nice to him?
No.
No. What did they do?
They put him in a lion's pit.
They put him in a pit, and then they sold him.
To Egypt.
Very good. Guys, good job, parents. They know their stories. And not only did he get sold to Egypt, he got put in prison when he was there. And then after prison, guess what God did? God used him to be one of the biggest rulers of all of Egypt. And he saved thousands, hundreds of thousands of people from starving. Did you know that God sometimes, even when something bad happens to us, he can make it turn out to be really good in the end? Yeah, sometimes even when people are mean or do things that are going to put us in a very bad situation, God looks at that situation and he says, you know what? I'm going to make it good for you because you're my child. And when we're God's child, he looks out for us just like your mom and dad do. You guys did so good today. Is there anyone who will have prayer for me? Yeah? Do you want to have prayer for me, Noah?
You
just want to tell me something? Oh, Daddy tells you Joseph's story all kinds of ways. Okay, you want to say prayer for me? Okay, let's bow our heads.
Dear Jesus, keep everyone safe.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, y'all. You can go back to your seats.
Well, what a good story. Story of Joseph. Thank you, thank you, thank you. That is Noah's favorite of all the stories, and he asks for it over and over again. It is time for one of the highlights that we get to enjoy here in Burleson once in a while, a baby dedication. And so Dan and Yolibet, would you guys come forward and bring little Jacob up here? And if there are our family or friends that would like to stand and in support of them, please feel free to do that at this time. If you have a camera, feel free to come wherever you want to be to get the picture you want to get, all right? So center aisle or wherever, you guys come on right here in the middle, all right? You guys come on over a little bit further here, right in the middle. All right, I know we got chairs here blocking the way, so... So today, I want to start by reading a Bible verse, and then I'm going to just do something a little different today. So Matthew 18, Jesus says, assuredly I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, and whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. Jesus loves children. Do you know that? He loves children, and he loves little Jacob. And today, instead of having a few words of wisdom to share, which we sometimes do, Dan and Yolibet have a powerful testimony to share, and I want to give them an opportunity to do that, okay? So this is going to be the baby dedication, then we're going to have prayer. So, how long has it been now since Jacob was born?
Over six months.
Okay, so I guess it was just right before that. I'll let you share the rest of the story. But I got a text from a pastor friend who knows Dan and Yolibet, and he said they're in the hospital. You might go by and see them. And so as soon as I could, the next day, Sunday, I went to see them in the hospital. And they were kind of towards the end of pregnancy, but they still had a little ways to go. About 8 months, or eight weeks left or so?
I was 4 weeks in the hospital, and then he was born. Yeah.
Okay, and he was born at 32?
1 in 5 days.
Okay. So I went to see them that day. We had prayer together, and... she had been in the hospital for a little while. And then some things happened later on that same evening. Maybe you guys can share the rest of the story with us, all right?
First of all, this little guy is our little miracle baby. We prayed hard for this guy. It took years before God blessed us with him. And then it was a rough pregnancy from the beginning. My wife had a lot of complications. And then she was in the hospital for about 4 weeks before the night of September 11th. Just after midnight, she had an emergency surgery to get him out. And then Jacob spent a little over 4 weeks in the neonatal ICU. But he did great while he was there. No complications. And then we finally got to bring him home.
Yeah, so we're very happy that Jacob is being a warrior since day one and even before. So it was very hard when we were in the hospital because, you know, it was I had preeclampsia and I had a placenta previa and I was bleeding. It was really, really hard. So my blood pressure got very high, like it was 190 over 110. So some of you may know that that's a really hard, high blood pressure. And so this is a miracle for him and for me because even though he was born early, he was complete, he was healthy. It's such a blessing. And I know that a lot of you been praying for us, even though you don't know us. Pastor Ryan had talked to you guys about us being in the hospital. And God definitely answered the prayers. Amen. So we're very, very happy. He's a joy in our lives. We couldn't be more happy than this. So thank you so much for everything. You can see him. He's happy right now. He's a little bit sleepy, but he's a happy boy, so, and a healthy boy. So thank you so much for everything.
They didn't share all the details with you, but that evening was the same evening that her blood pressure spiked, and she said she wasn't feeling good, and they rushed to kind of take some of her vitals and different things, and what they told her later is if they hadn't gone into and gotten the baby that night, what did they tell you?
Yeah, so that very same day, on Sunday, September the 11th, my friends put together a little baby shower because I didn't have time for anything because everything was in such a rush. And so I wasn't feeling good that day. And it was just thinking, and I was telling my husband, I don't feel good. I think he's going to be born today. I'd rather have him outside than inside because, you know, we don't know what can happen. And so that night, my blood pressure started going up, and then they took me to do an emergency C-section. When I was in right in the OR, it was when my blood pressure was so high that the anesthesiologist said, somebody's watching over you, because this blood pressure, you couldn't survive on the floor with this. You could have stroke or you could have died. And then as he was saying that, the surgeon was doing the C-section, and then she's like, he started crying when they took him out, and then the surgeon said, you leave it. For sure, God is watching over you because your placenta was holding this much before it ruptured. So that's a big, big testimony. So.
So God was watching over you, and he was also watching over Jacob, wasn't he? And you may remember the text and email that went out asking for prayer. Thank you so much for praying for the Adkisson family. We're going to have one more prayer now as we close things out for the baby dedication. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for Dan and for Yolibet and for little Jacob and for all the family and friends they have here to support them today. Father, we are standing here witnessing a miracle in the flesh. You have spared Yolibet's life, and you have brought them a precious, healthy baby little boy. And we're so grateful for that, Father. We know how much you love Jacob, and we know how much you love each member of this family, and Dan for him as well, keeping the family intact and them having a precious little family here. Father, we ask that you would continue to work miracles in their lives as they raise Jacob to know you, that you would continue to give them strength and wisdom as they raise Jacob to know you and to love you. We pray that you would give them a special blessing of your spirit in their home, that there would just be a sweetness of your spirit present as Jacob grows up to know you. Give him your protection, Father, as he grows. There so many things going on in this world right now, and we pray, Father, that you would protect him from those things that might hurt him, and that you would allow things in his life that will help him to grow and to develop into the person you want him to be. Father, we pray that as he grows, you will show him the calling that you have on his life for service to you, and whatever he does in the future, whatever career path he may take someday as an adult, that if time should last that long, Father, we pray that you would anoint him from this day forward for ministry, and the Spirit would be working in his life moving forward. Father, we leave Jacob in your hands. We have brought him to you to dedicate him to you. His mom and dad have brought him to you to dedicate him to you, to dedicate themselves to you. And Father, we put him in your hands from this day forward, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we have a little gift for you guys before you leave us, and it's a baby dedication certificate, a BAS baby bond when he's ready for school, a first month of tuition for free, a card, and then a little gift from the Southwestern Union office there in that package. All right? Thank you, guys.
We want to invite you to stand with us as we sing Even So Come. One, two, three, four, five, six.
All of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout out your fame. Jesus is coming soon,
like a bride.
All will be new, your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for a groom, we'll be your church ready. Even so come,
This next song, we have never done this song at Burleson, but I am almost positive that you guys have heard this song on the radio maybe, and if not, you might have heard it 2 weeks ago when Michael sang it at our church, and it was amazing. And when he was singing it, all I kept thinking was, I want my kids to do this song. Like, I want them to sing this song with him. And there is nothing more powerful than knowing that he is the one that takes our pain, that he is the way maker. These are things that I want them to know later in life when they encounter obstacles, when they encounter things. I want them to know that he's the way maker, he's the pain taker, he's the chain breaker. And so as we sing the song, I know we've never led it here, but I'm pretty sure you guys will catch on, and we just want to invite you to sing it with us.
Ready? You've been walking the same old road, miles and
miles.
You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside with a better life, there's a better life.
Come on, sing it out, here we go.
If you got changed, he's a chain taker. You feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom, saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker.
We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out by the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life.
If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, way maker.
Somebody testify. You believe and you receive it. You can feel it. Somebody testify.
The rest. We are actually missing some students, which is funny because we cannot even fit the ones we have right now, but we're missing quite a few, but we have quite a few new ones. And so one of the first songs that I teach them is How Great Is Our God. And that is what we're gonna sing. And this will be our Garden of Prayer song. So at the end of the song on the last chorus, you can just, kneel down, because you're not going to be able to come forward anyway. So you're just going to kneel down on the last chorus of this song.
How great
you may know at this time.
Dear Father God, thank you that we can come before you, that we can kneel before you. Thank you, Lord, that you have given us this incredibly wonderful weather where we can gather together in this church. Lord, we want to praise you for the children who have come forward and the youngsters have come forward to play guitar in your name and to sing in your name. Lord, we want to thank you for the opportunity to have the children in the church, to grow this church, to teach and to share with them your love, your truth. Lord, help us to be kind in our words and in our hearts as we approach those who need our help. We also come, Lord, asking for your assistance. Lord, we need your help in so many ways. We need your understanding, Lord. You know the end and the beginning. You know our own thoughts. You knew of us before we were even born. You know, Lord, the struggles we deal with. And we know, Lord, that you soon are going to take those burdens and remove them from us, but that while we have them, you will support us. You will give us your strength to continue to look to you as the source of all good. Lord, we also have burdens of financial burdens. We have relationship burdens, Lord. This world is filled with pain, and I know you suffer along with us. Lord, help our sufferings to bring us closer to you and not push us away from you. That is what we want, Lord. We want your presence in our hearts and our minds. Help us to become clearer thinkers and speakers for you. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to share with others. Thank you, Lord, for the chance to learn more about what you've said through those who teach, and most particularly, Lord, through your word. Thank you that you've given us the Bible and so many lessons of your character in there, so many ways in which you demonstrate what your plan is from the very beginning to the very end. It's all laid out. You've given us a clear picture, and now, Lord, help us to accept that and to follow it and do our best to do what your will is. For all we want, Lord, is your will to be done so that we will all be saved. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
All right. Thank you, praise team. Man, wasn't that a blessing? You know, every time the kids sing and share with us like they did today, I always have people that come to me. Maybe they aren't normally a part of the congregation here in Burleson and they're visiting or something, and they say, "That was amazing. We've never seen anything like that." And they say how big of a blessing it was to them. And so, kids, I just want to affirm you, tell you thank you, and thank you for your ministry. And I guess sometimes we take things for granted that are just that special, you know. But thank you, Maria, too, for leading. What a blessing that was. As we continue on, before we launch into the sermon, I want to mention something really quick. First of all, if you are a member here, you probably already know, but we have some meetings going on. If you're visiting here with us today, we would be happy to have you come out too. Our meetings are, we're studying Bible prophecy together, and most of us believe Jesus is coming soon, don't we? And so we are taking some time to study Bible prophecy together. This evening we have meetings at 5:30 and 7 o'clock, two meetings back-to-back with refreshments served. And we have meetings for the kids as well, ages 3 to 9. And if it's a 3-year-old, we ask a parent to be with the child. But the meetings for the kids are great, based off of a video curriculum entitled What's in the Bible, and very, very neat videos and educational as well regarding Scripture. So that is a lot of fun. Visitation teams, if you are going to be doing some visitation during the meetings, just a reminder that we're meeting with Pastor Corbett at 2:30 here at the church. All right, so if you're a table leader doing visitation or somebody else that has volunteered to do visitation to some of the visitors. 2:30 here at the church, and you know who you are because you've volunteered to do that, all right? So if you're thinking, is that me? It's probably not you, all right? All right, so let's have a word of prayer and pause just another moment before we head into the sermon. Father in heaven, right now would you once again send your Holy Spirit to be with us this morning. Anoint our eyes to see, our ears to hear, and our minds to receive what you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Jonathan Whitfield was preaching to some coal miners in England, when he asked a man one day, he said, "What do you believe?" And the man said this, "I believe the same thing as my church." And he wanted to get the guy thinking, and so he asked a deeper question. He said, "What does your church believe?" And he said, "Well, they believe the same thing that I do." And he was kind of flustered a little bit, but seeing that it was really going nowhere, he asked one final question, and it was this. He said, "And what is it that you both believe?" He had him. The man said, "Well, pretty much the same thing." How is your faith this morning? What is faith anyway? We'd like to talk about faith, but do we ever really think this concept through? What is it to have faith? The Bible does tell us that faith is very important, doesn't it? It is the means by which we lay hold of the righteousness of Christ, the Bible says. What is faith? You know, I think there are a lot of things that come to mind when we think about faith. We think of keeping the faith, right? What does that mean? I mean, when someone says, "Oh, keep the faith, brother," what does that mean? Someone translate that for me. What do you think of? Don't give up. Okay, I like that. I like that. Sometimes we mean you better keep doing this, that, and the other, right? But don't give up. I like that one better. Don't give up. In fact, there might be something in a definition for faith about that. Sometimes we think of faith as a religion. What faith are you? What's your religious background? Sometimes we think faith in terms of it's a good feeling about something. Oh, I've got faith that this is going to happen. It's a good feeling. And really, faith couldn't be farther from a feeling, by the way. It sometimes is accompanied by feelings that are good, and it sometimes the devil attacks us through our feelings, doesn't he? And sometimes we think that faith is simply just knowing that God exists. I know he exists, and I really believe that, and that's what faith is. Now, there's an element of faith, and we have different definitions for faith, granted, but faith, I mean, what is faith? The kind of faith that God wants us to have. A.T. Jones in the Review and Herald, December 6, 1898, he said this, "It is sadly true that though the Lord has made this perfectly plain in the Scriptures, there are many church members who do not know what faith is. They may even know what the definition of faith is, but they do not know what the thing is. They do not grasp the idea that is the definition." This, at his time, a great giant of understanding this topic, this idea of faith. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Could you go there with me? It'll be on the screen. If you have a Bible, feel free to turn with me there as well. Romans 12, verse 3 says this, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Right? Let's examine this scripture for just a moment. This is this chapter begins off talking about the service that we should offer to God and about being transformed by the renewing of our minds. And then Paul goes into to dealing with this faith experience, doesn't he? So here we get kind of a description of faith. Maybe not so much a definition, but we get a good description of faith. And what do we find here? We find that faith is a gift. It's a gift. This dealing out to every man a measure of faith. Faith is, first and foremost, a gift from God. Sometimes we think it's something we have to muster up, right? I just have to muster up enough faith to get through this. Maybe instead of doing that, we should kneel down and just seek the Lord and say, I don't have the faith to get through this. Please give me the measure of faith I need. Faith is a gift. Secondly, we are given enough for whatever we are going through. The Bible says that, doesn't it? He hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. The measure of faith that he needs, in other words. If we're willing to latch hold of that and to claim that gift, God says it is yours. But thirdly, let's think, before we think about what the result is, let's think about what the result of faith is not. What does the Bible say here in Romans 12:3? The Bible says this. It says that we should not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. You see, the result of faith is not spiritual pride, haughtiness, or thinking that we're better than anybody else. The result of faith is sober thinking or sound judgment, as the Bible puts it. How many of us need that in times of trial? I mean, just being assailed by the devil. And the Bible says you can have sound judgment and sober thinking in the midst of whatever you're going through. And God's saying, I'm ready to give you this gift, the measure that you need to get through whatever you're going through. A description of faith here. Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 10, there's a story, and in fact, about a year ago, a little over a year ago, we looked at this story in full. We're not going to study it through in full today, but I do want to draw a lesson from the story. The story of the centurion that met Jesus in Capernaum. And here's how the story goes. Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 10 says this, and when Jesus entered Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion, beseeching him, and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus saith unto him, I will come and heal him. Verse going on here, the centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to them that followed, verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. Why did Jesus say, and I'm paraphrasing here, this is the greatest faith that I have found in all of Israel? And he said it about a Roman centurion. Why did Jesus say that? Well, I wonder if it had to do with a few things. First of all, let's think about this. Jesus says, I will come and heal him. Jesus was giving this man an offering of his coming and literally physically being in the presence of the one that he loved and healing. All right? Jesus was offering that. And this man, you see, here's what's interesting. He says, no, that's not necessary. He says, you don't have to come, just speak the word only. You see, for the centurion, proximity did not matter. He understood who Jesus was, at least in the sense that he knew he was doing miracles. He knew he had power. He may not have understood the fullness of Jesus and who he was, but he understood who he was talking to. Somebody who was under authority and could use authority as well, right? To him, it didn't matter how close Jesus was to the one who needed help. The centurion truly believed in the all-powerful Jesus that we read about in Scripture. How many of us have a problem with Jesus' proximity to our problems? Do we sometimes have a little bit of a problem with that? I mean, we say, oh, I can't see him. Or, you know, he seems to be too far away, or I just talked to him, or if he just talked to me, or you know, I maybe I could have faith the way I need to have faith. What a lesson we have right here in this story. For the Roman centurion, it didn't matter how close Jesus was to the problem. He just needed to get the word to Jesus, right? He just needed for Jesus to hear so he could speak the word only. In fact, there's a powerful principle here that I want you to think about for a moment. This idea of the word only principle that we see in this story. Here's a description of the idea of faith a little bit better. Faith is expecting and depending upon the word of God, Jesus Christ, only to do what the word says. Expecting and depending. Did he expect a miracle? Yes, he did. Was he depending on a miracle? Yes, he was, wasn't he? Expecting and depending upon the word of God only to do what the word says. I want to talk a little bit about depending on Jesus. Who is this God that we serve? Who is this anyway? I want you to think back in your mind. Psalm 33 tells a story of a time much earlier. Psalm 33 verses 6 through 9 says, "By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. He gathereth the waters of the sea together as an heap. He layeth up the depth and storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spake, and it was done. And he commanded, and it stood fast." Is the word of God powerful? It is, isn't it? God is powerful. He speaks and things happen. He says the word and it's accomplished. How have we come to believe in such a puny God? The God of Scripture is a big God. Has he changed? No, he hasn't, has he? Have our expectations changed? Is that possible? That maybe our expectations might have changed some with the passage of time. You see, God spoke and there was light. He spoke and there was the firmament. He spoke and all of these things at creation happened. And it was so, the Bible says. And then we have the miracles of Jesus all through the New Testament and the Old Testament as well. Speak the word only. How about in your life? Do you think that we still have that same God that created the world as our God today? The same God that spoke and all of the planets appeared? The same God who spoke and the sun comes into being, moon and stars? The same God? We do. Sometimes, though, we're tempted to think that he is somehow less powerful now, or less interested in our lives, or less willing to work than in past times. Let me share a quote with you from the book Acts of the Apostles, page 50. Ellen White has something very interesting to say about this. She says this, the lapse of time between then, the Bible times, right? Between the time of the pouring out of the Holy Spirit on the early church, the lapse of time has wrought no change in Christ's parting promise to send the Holy Spirit as his representative. It is not because of any restriction on the part of God that the riches of his grace do not flow earthward toward men. If the fulfillment of the promise is not seen as it might be, it is because the promise is not appreciated as it should be. If all were willing, all would be filled with the Spirit. She goes on and says this, wherever the need of the Holy Spirit is a matter little thought of, there is seen spiritual drought, spiritual darkness, spiritual declension, and death. Whenever minor matters occupy the attention, the divine power which is necessary for the growth and prosperity of the church and which would bring all other blessings in its train is lacking, though offered in infinite plenitude. Man, think about those two words together. Plentitude is good, isn't it? You've got plenty. Infinite plenitude. Do we serve the same God? We do, don't we? Same God today as yesterday, as back in Bible times. Depending upon the Word of God, what he says in his word. 1 Corinthians 10:13, many of us know this passage. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. I want you to think about this for just a moment here. What do we expect when temptation comes? What do we expect? Is it possible that some of us need to adjust our expectations a little bit when temptation comes? I want you to process this for just a moment. You see, a lot of us think, oh man, not again. I'm tempted by this again. I'm going to blow it. I blew it last time. I know I'm going to fail. What should we expect when temptation comes? We should expect a way of escape. Okay, Lord, where is it? I faced this last time, I messed up. Where's my way of escape? Is God faithful to provide? Yes. Maybe he even wants us to pray for just a moment. Okay, please, Lord, help me escape. Provide a way, show me a way of escape here. What do we expect from God? Are we depending upon him according to the promises of his word? Depending, that's the second part there. We should depend on God and his promises as we seek strengthening to face what we're going through. God is faithful. The promises of his word are faithful. We can escape. We can bear the temptations, as the Bible says. Hudson Taylor was a missionary to China. He spent 51 years there in mission work, and he founded the China Inland Mission. The society that he began was responsible for bringing over 800 missionaries to the country, who began 125 schools and directly resulted in 18,000 Christian conversions, as well as the establishment of more than 300 stations of work with more than 500 local helpers in all 18 provinces. And here's what Hudson Taylor said about faith. This is just one quote. I'm a man of faith. But here's one thing he said about faith. He said this, God is not looking for men of great faith. He is looking for men who will trust his great faithfulness. Let that sink in for a moment. If we truly believe God's the giver of faith, we need to be bigger, believers in his faithfulness than we need to do in ourselves of, I'm a person of great faith. I think that's kind of what Hudson Taylor was getting at there. But there was a quote from Hudson Taylor that's even more striking to me than this one. You see, there was a time when he was facing great financial hardship in the ministry that he was a part of, that he had kind of pioneered there. And he wrote a letter to his wife at that time, and he said this: "We have 25 cents and all the promises of God." Do you like that? Next time you're getting ready to pay bills after you return tithe and offerings, and I've got this and all the promises of God, right? Wow. I hope you're getting a sense for the God that we serve, what he wants to do in our lives, expecting God to work, depending upon God to work. A.T. Jones, Review and Herald, February 7, 1899, said this. He said, "When every conceivable ground of hope of any dependence on anything in or about himself is gone and is acknowledged to be gone, when everything that can be seen is against any hope of justification, then it is that throwing himself upon the promise of God, upon the word only, hoping against hope, faith enters, and by faith he finds justification full and free, all ungodly though he be." Entering into the realm of salvation here, faith is also this thing that God wants us to receive and then use that faith, exercise it to lay hold of the gift of salvation. But the Bible says that there are certain things and conditions that we have to be in to receive, right? Romans chapter 3, talking about this idea that we must realize that there is nothing good in us. We come to God, just like A.T. Jones said, we come to God, and we have to come to him to receive justification, just realizing there's nothing good in me, but I have come to receive all of your goodness, and I want you to change me from the inside out. That's the message of salvation. But guess what? It's also based on the promises of God. And we can expect that he will fulfill those promises, and we can depend on those promises as well, can't we? He promises salvation to us. We can expect it. It's a gift. We can expect it, and we can depend on those special promises of his word. How is your faith this morning? What are we putting our trust and our hope in? Are we fixing our hope and our trust on other things in this life? Nice cars, houses, new stuff, relationships above Jesus. What is it that we are putting our faith and our trust in? Or are we turning wholeheartedly to Jesus and saying, "I need you. I'm here expecting from you, and I'm here to receive from you." Romans 10:17, one last thought from Scripture here, says this: "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." It is so important, church, if we are going to be growing in faith, that we be in the word of God on a regular basis. We have got to be in his word, seeking him, seeking the person of Jesus Christ in his word. And let me tell you, church, I know some of you are heavily involved in other things in life, and yet you have volunteered much of your time for the meetings that we're in right now. And many of you are going to need an extra special gift of faith from God to get through it. That's part of the reason I'm sharing this message with you today. But as busy as you might be in this whole next month, do not neglect your time with God. Don't neglect those precious hours, the morning hours or evening hours after things have quieted down. Don't neglect that time. So important for your faith journey as you're seeking to lead others to him. As we close, I'm going to invite our group up. I'm going to share with you a Connect card here. And then One Direction is going to come forward and share a special music with us. The Connect card, if this is in your bulletin here, if you flip it over to the back side, it's just a little index card size. My next step is today, maybe some of you have a decision that God is calling you to and you want us to pray for you about it, or there's something else you'd like to use this card for, maybe beginning a relationship with Jesus, let us know. We'd love to talk with you. Baptism information, membership transfer, Bible studies, a visit from a pastor or elder. Share a prayer request with us. But I want to hit these two points here really quick. My next step today is, I am so grateful that God gives me the faith that I need for my specific situation. Maybe some of you just want to praise Him today for His faithfulness. Secondly, I want to begin living by faith, expecting and depending upon the Word of God, Jesus Christ, to do what the Word says. And if that's your desire, you can check that box. One short story as they're getting set up here. One night, a house caught fire, and a young boy was forced to flee to the roof. And from below, the flames and the smoke were billowing up, and down below, his dad was down there, and he was talking to his son, and he could hear his dad's voice, but he couldn't see him because the smoke was just right in front of his eyes, and his eyes were burning, and his dad said, "Son, I can see you. Jump. Jump and I'll catch you." And he said, "Dad, I can't see you. I'm sorry. I can't do it, Dad. It's too high and scary." And he says, I can't see you. Are you really down there?" He says, "Yes, I'm down here. Trust me. I'm here." And he says, but I can't see you." And he says, "Well, son, I know you can't see me, but I can see you. And if you jump, I will catch you." And he jumped. Today, what is it? What is that leap for you that you're saying, "God, I just can't see it. Maybe you're calling me to do this, but I can't see it." Whatever it is, I encourage you to take the leap, because God is waiting to catch you when you jump. He is a good, good Father, and He will catch you if you take a step in faith. Thank you guys for being here to share with us. As they sing, the deacons will be coming around with some little baskets, and they're going to share a special song with us right now. Thank you so much. What's that? Oh, what did I, say? What, One Direction? Where did that come from? One Vision. That's much better. That was either my mind or, I'm not even sure what it says in the bulletin. That's what I wrote down.
Testing.
Oh, thanks. Thank you. That took courage to say that.
Here and now I'm in the fire and above my joy. working time is. Oh, the joy of the Lord, it will be my strength. When the pressure is on, he's making diamonds. Oh, the joy of the Lord, it will be my strength. When the pressure is on, he's making diamonds.
Amen. One vision. Thank you so much. Thank you. As we close the service today, our altar team will be over here on the side, and they'll be here to minister to you. If you need some prayer or want to pray with them for someone else, go and visit our altar team. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer as we close. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace in the name of Jesus. Amen.